So this is different from the slip line.
That's water.
Yep, see on the chain, it was like, you know, 22nd.
Yeah, she had the December one, all the old form, the December change. Alan had those. Had the old one. Too bad.
Actually, I think there were additions in that, but.
Most of December.
But the only one recently. I'm good.
So if we want everybody's here, so now we'll just go ahead and start the meeting. So the first order on the agenda was to discuss the letter that I sent, requested regarding Chair Alan Robinson and his resign. So I guess it's open for discussion, what folks want to do, what we have to do then.
I would accept Alan's resignation from the committee.
Second, any discussion? Any aye, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Yep.
There being a vacancy, I'd like to make a motion to fill the vacancy with the next highest vote. Yeah, or, yes, that's the term, for the one-year position, which would be Ed Jensen.
Second. Any discussion?
Well, I mean, if you're looking at the entire expense for the budget committee, Miles only received the next highest votes for the budget committee, but you don't have to get some votes up here. So doesn't seem rational to ask Miles if he wanted to serve on the budget committee.
There's a motion on the floor already.
Something to discuss.
That's an open discussion, so it's.
Okay, all right.
My recommendation based on this is that we notify everyone who was running the budget committee last year, find the interest of who we'd like to serve, and then to address it at the next meeting. I think it's too soon right now.
My question is, was Mr. Crozier's statement incorrect? Is, who is the next highest voter for the one-year position?
Ed Jensen.
You can't base it.
Are we filling a one-year position?
Yes.
So it's a one-year position that we're filling?
That's my Alan and Paul.
It would be just a March amount.
Right.
It would only be to March. And I'll just say again that, you know, Miles got 235 votes, which, and the next highest after that at all, it's a real drop off. It's like 183 or something like that, so. I like the idea of, somebody suggested, I think it was you, just asking all the voters.
Alan ran for the one year, so that's what it's based on, is he ran for the one-year position. So the next highest vote getter in the one-year position would be Ed.
I know that the budget committee has traditionally filled based on the next highest vote getter, but that is not required. The school board, no matter what it is, puts it out to the public to see who's interested, to see who might want to serve. It's not required to appoint someone, I just want to let everyone know that. It's not required to appoint someone who ran for that position. So just so we all keep that in mind.
And the historical data will show you that the next highest vote getter did not get appointed in previous years. Some have, some have not. So it is the choice, in fact, that was the choice of the chair, not the committee. But I do believe that the committee should
right, I wanted any of the exactly.
Historically, I think, you know, we've gone back to about whether we differentiate between a 1-3 position, I don't recall. But I understand it was a 1-year position that was run for, it was a 1-year position that's vacated. So I agree with you about the 1-year position.
That's one.
I don't say that. I agree with you, Tim. I think that 1-year that's what we have for other positions, yeah. We should be voting on that. We could vote on that tonight.
Well, if this comes up for a vote, I will vote no, not because I don't like Mr. Jensen, because I do. I just think the process is not necessarily fair, so I would either agree with Denise to go back and check in with all the vote getters, or check in with the next highest overall vote getter that's in the assembly. But that's the other, it's just a process. If I vote no, it is a process issue, not an issue against Mr. Jensen.
But I have a comment. If we were to go back and say, all right, all folks who ran, who's interested, and let's say, for the sake of argument, every single person said they were interested, where are we at that point? What would be the, you know, the decision? Are we then going to the highest voter, vote getter, or are we, you know, I don't know.
It still comes down to the vote.
Right, it would be a nomination from a member of the, from the members here, and then you would place it in vote.
Can't we do that tonight?
Mm-hmm. I think we're doing it too quick.
No, I don't think so. I think
we are. Yeah.
No.
Well,
I think we should do it here tonight.
Is motion on the
table?
Yeah,
we should vote to have Miles England or.
Well, the motion is that the next highest vote getter is Mr. Jensen, so we would be voting on whether Mr. Jensen would be the replacement.
Could you please clarify that it's the next highest, it's really not the next highest vote getter for the budget committee. It's the next highest vote getter if you're going to slice it and dice it.
By the year term.
Which is convenient for certain folks here. But, so I'm just saying.
Okay.
Correct.
Bill.
I'm all in favor of the next highest vote getter. What I've hung up on is on parsing it for the 1-year term or the budget committee or how we're doing it. That's what I'm hung up on, and I'm trying to think what's the right way to do it. I don't know if there is, but that's, I agree, I think it should be, because the people voted for the folks to be on the budget committee, and so the people got a number of votes, and at that point we should go with the vote getters, but yes, I'm pondering what is the best way to do it, what is the fairest way to do it. So that's my conundrum, I guess, where I am. So what I have left.
Is a motion to call the vote?
I want to make just a comment that I agree with Bill that.
Either way, whoever is appointed serves in for more.
Correct.
Right. That same. So how much damage can they do, right?
True. But
that sort of
negates the point that it should be the person for the 1-year term, in my mind. Because they're only serving until March anyway. And then, that to me bolsters the argument that it should be the next highest overall vote getter, which I guess would be Mr. England, is that correct? And then is Mr. Jensen after?
No. After that, it is, after Angela Matthews.
So,
No.
Yes. I'm confused because when you got the 3-year term, you got 3 people that could get a vote. On the 1-term, yeah, you only got 1. So if you're running for 3 years, you get more votes than you would if you run for 1 year. The position we're trying to fill is a one-year. Alan's position, who was filling in for an accountant, I believe.
No.
No, he ran.
No, that was a one-year position. Because there was a vacancy for only 1 year.
Yeah, because Carlton ran for 3 years. He got voted in. He passed away, and Carrie filled in for 1 year, I believe. She filled in for the 1 year, so if they had to have another election for 1 year. And Alan ran for that, and it was a high vote get. So that's the position I'm looking at. Just my thought.
Again, you know, I'll just comment that I think I get those points that no matter who it is, they're done in March. They have to really, you know, put themselves out there again for an election. So I don't even know that the 1 year or 3 year matters at that point. Do we want to vote on Mr. Jansen? And
that's
on
the
motion
that's
on the floor?
We have a motion on the floor.
Is that what we want to do?
I think we have to.
Well,
I think we have to go to the motion on the floor. However, I do believe there's behind the scenes actions in town here that, because Mr. Jansen is even sitting here waiting for this vote, I think that we should defer it. We can ask Mr. England as he's also, and you can have the two candidates, but not tonight. That's my opinion.
What do you mean?
Oh, you know what I'm talking about, then. So don't put it down. For God's sakes. We know.
We call the question.
So on the floor is to ask Mr. Jansen as the next highest vote getter for the 1 year term to whether you say yay or nay to him replacing him. So all in favor?
Can we have a roll call from that?
Sure. I'll start. Okay, I'll start. Yes.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No. Yes.
No.
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 Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Huh?
Six yes. And how many no's?
Okay.
That equals a total. All right. Under the law, we can actually swear Ed into office tonight. Because the state constitution says the moderator, town clerk, one of the selectmen, or a justice of the peace may administer the oath of office. Jody,
can I just make a point of order, please? Just to what Denise says, I mean, it's interesting that you already have something there for an action that most of us didn't know was going to happen tonight.
Right.
So that just kind of bolsters what
Denise said.
Well.
We'll just leave it at that. I'm just making that point, and it's on.
Well, I need to respond to what is implied.
We're not
going to
have a back and we're not having a back and forth. You have to put everything through the acting chair, please. Not a back and forth.
Well, I do need to respond to the implied accusation. That is, I'm just prepared. I've got.
Thank you.
Just started. Let's not vote things back. We and them. I'm sick of this beat. Can you control it?
Where's the cats?
It didn't bring you the cats.
So, I don't know if we need to vote on Mr. Jansen being sworn in tonight. I mean, if all parties are here, I suppose that's what we do.
Judy? Is Judy Perry?
No.
Oh, no. Unless Suzanne would like to do this.
Yeah, I don't know.
You want to copy what the oath looks like?
No, it's a sitting member. They're asking Suzanne to do it, right? Correct?
I believe you said any member of the select board.
Yeah. Only select.
And some of us are saying it probably should not be a sitting member.
Oh,
right.
Not be. I didn't hear
right.
The not.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Sorry, Suzanne. I thought I heard.
No, no, so, Jody, is that, are you prepared to do that? Okay.
No, thank you. Constitution.
not, we got the majority.
Did you raise your hand? Earl of Office, I state your name.
I, Andrew Chan.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
Affirm.
Affirm.
That I will bear faith. I will bear faith.
I will bear faith.
And true allegiance.
And true allegiance.
To the United States of America.
To the United States of America.
And to the state of New Hampshire.
And to the state of New Hampshire.
With support of the Constitution thereof.
With support of the Constitution thereof.
So help me God.
So help me God.
This I do under the pains and penalties of perjury.
This I do under the pains of perjury and.
Penalty of perjury.
Perjury.
I state your name.
I, Andrew Chan.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
And affirm that I will faithfully and impartially discharge from all duties incumbent.
That I will faithfully.
And impartially.
And impartially.
Discharge.
Discharge.
Perform all duties.
Perform all duties.
Incumbent of me.
Incumbent of me.
As a member of the Budget Committee.
As a member of the Budget Committee.
According with the, according to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations of this Constitution. Of this Constitution. And laws of the state of New Hampshire.
And laws of the state of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
This is under the pains and penalty of perjury. Pains and penalty.
Pains and penalty of perjury.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Oh, 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 oh. He's gonna sign it, you're gonna sign it.
I think it's important that we just know this process that we decide on, or that is voted on this year, that we filled a one-year position with a one-year candidate versus a two-year candidate. So when we look back, we'll have it in the minutes.
Did Jen Conley have done it, Judy? We did not vote on the process, we voted on a specific motion. So, we voted on a specific motion, not on a process this evening.
About what the process was.
It's not what we voted on, it's not what we voted on.
Well, that the majority voted on.
Or maybe, no, we all voted.
The majority.
We did not vote on a process, we voted on a specific motion. There is a difference.
The method in which we selected.
Guys, we can't do this.
I really can't.
I apologize.
We can't. Go ahead.
Just a final comment, perhaps, we had a letter that was sent by a member here that says, and I quote, "In the interest of an open and transparent governance, I strongly believe," and this is about Alan's letter, "I believe it should be shared in advance like all other material that you review by the committee." So what happened here?
Right.
It was, how can we, you know, I'm dumbfounded. I really don't with this process. And certainly nothing against Mr. Jordan, but this is, wow. I'll leave it. Thank you.
Why don't we just use the word scum?
Okay. Pam, ready to vote?
You know, I agree with this. You know, if there's a one-year position that both candidates were in for, the one-year position is vacant. So in my mind, we go back to the other one-year candidate. That's how I made that decision.
Let me just make the final comment that I don't think it matters if we voted on a person April 26th minutes, which Corey, we asked to make some amendments to, and then they were sent back out. So if there's anybody have any other changes to that, the April 26th minutes?
I move we accept the April 26th minutes as amended.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Then we also have the August 2nd minutes, which were new. Do you look at? Did anybody have any changes to the April 2nd minutes? I'm sorry, August 2nd.
I move to approve the August 2nd minutes. As submitted.
Was it August 2nd or August 8th?
It was actually August 2nd. That is a change. It was titled August 8th, but the date of the year was August 2nd.
Thank you.
So I can take that.
Yes. Okay, so then we'll wait until next time.
That's an edit, so I think we can probably.
Yeah,
I think we'll probably accept them tonight this evening. So
you're gonna have to hand feed me here.
So I move to accept the August 2nd minutes with the date change indicated with the August 2nd.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Doesn't matter who would like to go first, Suzanne or Dennis or?
I could go.
Okay.
We're in the fourth quarter and we're trying to push things up. And we have a new superintendent. All three pipes.
How does that?
It was just
care if the contractors can do it.
It's a tight area, but, you know, they usually do it. In fact, Pine Street, you had the whole fight.
That was known.
Yeah, that was known. The other two fights. They didn't break the gas pump.
Can you clarify, I'm not sure, so you said they, the contractors took care of it?
The contractors covered the expense of repairing the place, and I don't know exactly what happened, but they did. On Willis, on Pine Street, they installed gate valves because they had been no shut-offs or gate valves before. That was at the water district expense, but that had been discussed by the engineers before, so that was, you know. And as long as we're on this topic, and I know it's not really budget, but I do want to thank the water district for their patience and their support of our project, which, and
I think we worked pretty well together.
Yes, so it worked out well.
Well, it's a great job.
We thank, yes, we thank the water district.
Couple things, 64% is your expenditure?
Yes, from the, up until now, we still have bills that we're paying.
And a question on your personnel expenses, is that C29, 29, 29, 29, 65 for September, what gives?
Personnel, let's see, I'm not sure, we just hired a guy.
Water or sewer?
Water.
That's water, yeah, so that's between water and sewer, okay? You go back in the sewer and look at personnel.
Yeah, so it's the same.
And it's divided up, yes.
Okay, so why, what's the jump for? I mean, why are we at 29 and anywhere else? I see 42 in March, but what's the big jump?
We just hired a guy, and I'll tell you what, we're paying him more money than anybody else.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Would you have?
We're paying him a lot more money.
Did you have some kind of payout, you know, sick leave or whatever?
Oh, we did pay, yes, we did, I'm sorry, yes, we did pay John. That's right. That's what we do, we get a bonus at the end of the year, so whatever adds up to the amount of money that they get September, the hours of work. He left on September. So.
And I see you're still with that.
Yep.
Just all, you're still, you know, that line is 67% expected.
Yeah, so no, it's.
You might be at 75. That's what I look at.
Next year, you're going to see a change. We're also looking at that. Yeah, so water is, I think you said 64.1%. Any questions from the line? So we look down the wastewater and sewer, that's 69.4, okay? And like I said, we've got some projects coming up. We've got Pooh Street, someone wants to build a house on top of the hill, on the rock pile. So we might have to do some work out there too, you know, to extend the pipe a little bit. Maybe either that or they want septic, and I don't, we don't want septic.
Private sector.
Private sector, yeah. And it's all ledge. All ledge.
Was that, yeah? Was that at?
That's on Spruce Street.
Spruce Street.
Up on, right on the top. We got a few pumps to replace, and you guys are going to let me go, but you know, we want to see wastewater. And we're looking at pumps, the better pumps than what we got. Things differently, it's going to cost a little more. Hopefully, things will work out there, you know. Any other questions?
I have copies of the executive summary for people and also the report, so I'll just send them around if you need them.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm happy to report that things are fine on both the expense side and the revenue side, despite the fact that on the expense side we had significant overages in the town hall maintenance line and in the highway department lines, but we've been able to rebudget and find the money elsewhere, so we're not anticipating any difficulties from here on out. But one difficulty or potential surprise that I mentioned in the summary was the final financial reports to come out on the culvert projects. And while I don't have the official reports, I did hear today that we are likely to be within budget on the culvert project. So that's good news for us. So for the town, there we go. Also, since quarter three finished, the town, as you know, we have a new road agent, George Gilmet, and we were in dire need of snowplow drivers. We have also received a recommendation from the committee that hired George that we should seriously consider having a full-time highway department assistant. So we were planning that in the budget. The budget was being worked to do that. And as we sat down with George and had some discussions, we actually decided it was probably in the best interest of all of us to hire that person now, someone with a CDL license. So we put out a job description, we checked the budget. The money will largely come from within the highway department, given that we've also rebudgeted the highway department. So we're still fine even with hiring of that one? Yes. Yes. Yeah, I do, because we have to do it for next year. I'll give you a minute. That's for the remainder of the year.
Yeah.
Kim is asking.
And
just a follow-up,
are you expecting to sub out
West
more?
Yes. And George is very keen on that. So I suspect that that will happen. All right, so for and the entire year, benefits, health insurance, retirement system, to be under $57,000.
And what is the estimated salary for the highway agent?
Our road agent? Current one we've already hired? We hired him at 52. Salary is 52, so that's the retirement system health.
So $80,000 is not really budget for that.
Right after that, that's correct. But that is FY18. Ditching, shoulder work. Jody is furiously waving her hand. Can we ask if that's all right?
Sure, go ahead and work with the board. I've been transitional equipment in transition. One of the things that we can do, shoulder work alone, as you all know, is that plumbing that constantly is. $1,000 for a piece about as big as this plate pile thing. So when we went gentleman, by the name of Blake, who took his name completely off the table, saying, this is not a one-man job, you have to have more than one person. He took his name right off the table, stopped the interview right then and there, so.
I mean, there are other reasons, other than outlined by Jody, for why it's useful to have a second full-time other person. And I'm not quite sanguine as thinking that this will pay itself in 2 years. I mean, I think that what we're gonna be able to do is provide additional services that we haven't been able to do. Not just things that we've subbed out, but additional, you know, maintenance work that we, you know, just can't do if we're just one person. So there could be an upgrade in the overall look and feel of the town from a maintenance perspective point of view. Also from a redundancy point of view, we're really vulnerable, you know, when we have just one person who's there to do something. And it's unfair to have one person be always on call, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And so this allows us to manage that in a fairer, more responsible kind of way. But I don't know that I could say that, you know, it's going to necessarily pay for itself. I just think it is a good move. It's not a cheap move, but it makes sense for our town. We're not getting smaller. You know, we'll be adding Chimber development as a road, I suspect, at some point. So, you know, all of those things, that some of the things, too, that we didn't mention, I think we'll be able to do is flagging. You know, they'll be trained, both of them will be trained as flaggers. I think our current road agent already is certified. So that when we're doing road work, and other than our major roads, you know, doing ordinance to say our major roads are police provides the detail. But they can also waive that for when we do heritage or woods run. You know, we'll be able to supply our own flaggers. And that will save us a lot of money. So, you know, there will be some savings, and it is an expensive next step, and they're both true. I don't have any, you know, those were the big items. You know, the summary talked about, you know, where we had some difficulty this year and how we've managed to building in our budget to cover those issues.
I have a question about your single screen. So aside from the obvious that it's cheaper, was that the only reason to switch to Shipyard versus Bernard?
Bernard was doing single screen for us. So this we did this, I think, last year, sometime during FY16.
Mm-hmm.
Bernard came to us and said, you know, because we had an opt-out clause in the contract on both sides. He says, I can't do it at this price anymore. And so it caused us to go out and look around. And so we hired Shipyard. And they kept their we're month to month, we don't have a contract. So they have not raised their prices. I suspect if fuel prices go up, because that's the biggest expense, we'll see a rise in Shipyard.
With single stream, they are separating the items.
We are not.
They're not just throwing
them. Shipyard is hauling. Shipyard isn't separating either. Shipyard is bringing them to a third party who does the...
Okay, but they're separating.
Yes, it is. They are being recycled.
Okay.
It is recycled. Yes. It's just that we're not doing it, nor is Shipyard doing it.
But somebody's doing it.
Yeah, man. Somewhere in South Portland.
Huh?
Yeah.
Ark is doing it right next door.
Okay.
Well, commodities, the recycling single stream is just a cost.
Yeah.
There's no money there. But yes, if you look at the revenue, I don't know if you have that level of detail, but we get it from cardboard, we get it from metal, on recycling, and then, you know, other revenues, demolition fees. Recycling is cardboard, metal.
Yeah, have the demolition fees gone up?
No, not since, I think, 2015 or 2015. We can look at them at any time, and so maybe with George we could sit down and take a look at that to see if it's keeping up. I know we instituted a new one last year, I believe, sometime during the year for some item.
Great.
Pardon?
Leon.
So we're about, we're not having any good, this is all not going to, we're not going to, bad paper bags or.
Well, that's an interesting question. It's not a 43 review question, but I will say, we're having a public hearing in a couple of weeks. It should be out there soon. We are proposing an increase to the transfer station sticker from $10 to $20. Which equates to $1.67 a year. A month, I'm sorry, $1.67 a month. But again, that's, you know, please come to the public hearing.
As a landlord, who now pays for everything, get rid of it, and you put the private bag in there, how are you going to allocate the gate gap between renters and landlords? How are you?
We're not proposing a bagging tag, although personally, I think we should look at that, but we're not proposing a bagging tag. We're just proposing an increase to the transfer station sticker.
Overall operating budget 65.6%. Any big issues that you see coming up last quarter, or we look good?
We look good. I mean, the big issues that we've had during the year was the overage in the highway department because of the winter, because of accidents, because of termination pay for a road agent. There were several things like that, and now an increased salary. But we're covering that. Town hall maintenance, we had some big pieces that had to be replaced. We covered that. Revenues coming in as anticipated. So, you know, and since quarter three, you know, we're in the process of hiring a full-time assistant. We're going to cover that. And we found out just today that we're likely going to be within budget on the culvert project, which was the big unknown that had me worried, because you don't know until somebody gathers and compiles all the numbers and gives them to you. So.
Excellent. Congratulations.
Thank you.
For us.
For all of us, exactly. From the town meeting to now, for all of us. Congratulations.
Hey, Ken. So, do you mean, are you anticipating these town hall repairs? And why is it all 8% for the prices more than double what?
Can you tell us where you are, Ken?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Line 93. 94. Line 94.
Could you check the top to see if it says January, September 2016? Oh, you're looking on your computer.
The town hall repairs. So it was originally budgeted at 12, it's now at 26.9.
We'll close this out.
And it says 84% canceled, 70% expended. So you just adjusted 94?
It's 94% of 20 of the rebudgeted, of the revised budget, right? Not of the original budget. Does that make sense?
It does. I don't think we did that way before.
I don't believe that we've. I instituted a sort of revised budget just last year at some point. Mm-hmm. Because the board needs to know, you know, you can't just say, oh, yeah, remember we said we'd cover that with this? I mean, so this makes us explicitly re-budget so that we're still coming out with the bottom line budget dollars that we're supposed to come out with, and we know how we're covering things. But on the same, by the same token, if I'm looking at, well, how are we doing now with that revised budget? You know, we're 84.7% for that.
So just so I'm clear, you basically move funds from another line item.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Just as a point, this says 2016, but I'm assuming it's 17.
Nope.
No. Yeah.
Where is this?
The paper one?
Can I see this just
a minute? Well, no. Dennis is right.
No, I'm looking at this.
16.
This one.
The ones that were handed out from last year.
The quarterly budget report says 2016 and 2015.
Yeah, they're all 2016.
I'm so sorry.
Okay.
I don't know
that's
how that happened.
No, thank you.
I'm really sorry. I don't even know where it might have come from.
16?
Yeah.
Does anybody like at a loss with?
We have some copies of you. I mean, I know that Charlie has one, Dennis has one here. If people want to look on, or
I'm peeking on with Bill. Do you? So.
Unless you can share with him. You can.
Don't worry about that.
She has one. She has one here.
Maybe over, there's no computer with Denise.
I have a red copy.
Ed, I'll use my back because it has me.
Not some smartphone after all, huh?
Any other questions, comments?
Yep. So if you took money from other line items, do you indicate that where they came, where it came from?
Well, I did it first and then it got complicated, you know, because you go back to the well. I mean, if you look at one source is obviously line 26, professional services. So we took a bit from there. We took also $1,000 from IT above it. But they come from hither and yon. You know, there was something under elections where, for example, line 40, we knew we weren't going to have any other expenses, and it was it was over $1,000, so we did, we moved to that.
Okay.
That's the nature of the kinds of moves that we were making. Yeah.
Is it safe to say that, at least on the electronic version, anytime you've made a move, you're highlighting in yellow?
Yes, that's correct.
Right.
So
that's very helpful for me to be able to see that.
Yeah, so there are probably, there are more decreases, I think, than increases until you get to the highway department. Those are all
It looks like you took about $14,000 out of contingency. That's the biggest chunk.
Yeah, we pretty much cleaned out contingency. Yeah.
14. 16. Yeah, 16. We're running 16. Almost 16.
Can I ask a question? And maybe the police will talk about this when they come. But what happened when we didn't even get the officer out of the academy, and we lost?
We've had struggles. I mean, that's, we've had struggles. However, we have someone in the academy now who's doing well, so that would fill out our complement.
So this person was...
Well, I really am not fond of this patrol officer, 1-2-3, I don't even know who they are. So...
Okay, so we can wait and ask him, but I just wonder, is it the age-old problem? I mean, and
it's
I've never been a police officer, but I would think that a quiet town where you're less likely to get your head blown off would be desirable for somebody.
Well, we don't offer much money.
Right.
So for market conditions, we're not offering much money. We are attractive in the way that you just mentioned, however. How much value that adds, I think it depends on the person and the person's ambition. You know, we don't have a career path. They're too small to be able to offer a career path. So that's kind of a deficiency as well.
Yeah, I have a question. If a prospective officer doesn't even make it through the academy, but do we still have to pay a portion of that, or is there some sort of contract where we don't pay if they don't complete even the academy?
We don't pay for the academy.
We don't pay for the academy, but we pay this person
but
a
we
salary.
We are paying the salary.
Okay.
We have provided some.
We've provided uniforms and things.
So
right.
I'm not going to say
right.
that it hasn't been an expensive proposition for the town, because there are those kinds of expenses.
Thank you. I wasn't sure if we actually paid the academy as well as the person, but thank you.
I thought one time we did pay for the academy. There was some agreement about if you left within a certain period of time. Yeah.
A lot of departments went to a model where they made the officers sign a contract saying, you need to, you know, we're going to hire you, we're going to send you to the academy. If you leave within 3 years, you will owe us a portion of whatever. Because hiring, equipping, and training new police officers is incredibly expensive. And you really don't start getting a return on them for 2 years. When you can put somebody out there on their own and be confident and comfortable, at least that was my experience in courts. But 2 years, Mark, the men and women you put out there, you can say, okay, I think he or she knows what they're doing and feel comfortable about it. Before that, you know, you're always just concerned because they're new and they don't know. So it's a big expense, but the academy has never been a fee for.
Well, the question is, does the town have an arrangement?
Yes, I believe we do, but I think it starts after the academy.
Right.
So they have,
we haven't had an office, we haven't had a new officer finish the academy.
Well, my concern is, and I believe it was something that was an issue in the past, was other towns poaching our post-academy people and saying, no, no, you're not going to do that to us anymore.
I would encourage, I mean, ask Chief Ducharme when he comes. I mean, he would, you know, I'm telling you what I think it happens, but he, I don't
think. I think that was the intent, was to prevent them from going to other departments. But if, and I don't know, if somebody doesn't make it through the academy because they, you know, they either don't make it, that's a different story. I don't know what the contract arrangement is, if we can, you know, hold somebody accountable. They tried, and if they couldn't make it, and I don't know if that, if we've experienced that here, somebody that hasn't made it through.
Well, we're kind of going into the gray area of
personnel-related
stuff, so there's not much I'm going to say other than we haven't had any of these new recruits complete successfully with the academy.
And it's 16 weeks now, too.
Dennis? Wouldn't they want to get an associate's degree or a bachelor's degree in criminal justice before they even thought they were going to be a policeman? What, do you just hire them out of high school?
I think, not to stop your question, but I think the chief would probably be better equipped to know that. I mean, he would be the one we should probably be asking those types of questions.
Yeah, well, we will.
Suzanne would even know.
Because I got a job at St. Joe's. He's criminal justice right now, and he's going to get a bachelor's degree, hopefully. So anyway, that's my thought. You don't pay him all his money, but get something out of him.
Does anybody have any other comments, questions, concerns, Nancy?
The lieutenant salary, is that the salary we came in approved in March, the 58,817?
We provided the lieutenant with a salary increase at some point during the year.
Yes, but so the approved appropriation is the one that we voted on, or is that including the money that you appropriated?
You mean the 58,817?
Yes.
That was the appropriated amount, yes.
That was what
Well, that was our. I mean, that's the town doesn't. The town votes in the bottom line, right? So.
But that's what the figures were in
yes,
March.
Yes.
And you had since added to that, or is this the added amount? I guess that's what I'm trying to.
I'm losing sight of when we did this.
2 weeks after the meeting. In March.
I would say we probably haven't added it, so we might have an overage on that line. But it's going to be covered by another line, so it really is not an issue because it will go over.
Just was curious because I know that it had been added that he had gotten an increase.
Yeah, I mean the police department is so good about keeping within their budget that you know we didn't try to move things around. We just knew it was all going to be kept within that budget anyway. So.
Can you talk about some of the vehicle repairs and maintenance and accidents for the highway department?
Yes.
Line 205.
So first of all, as I was looking at this, we have an equipment line at 202, and we have vehicle repair maintenance at 205. You see that? So I asked Caroline, because they were really kind of jumbled up, I asked her to move all of the actual, really, the running of the vehicle kinds of expenses to equipment. So the repairs to snow blades, snow plow radios is now in the equipment line, which is still overextended. And then the vehicles themselves are in the vehicle line. So there were a number of issues with snow plowing equipment, with blades that had to be repaired or hydraulics associated with this or that. I'm not going to remember specifically, but there was a lot of stuff. And even into August when they were gearing up, when Jeff was still here to get ready for the coming winter. The accidents, we had a couple of accidents. We thought that we were going to be able to run it, the payment directly from the climax to the repair person, and it didn't work out that way. So that caused us to have to expend it from our own budget, and that was about $4,000 that you know we didn't even think we'd have to sort of re-budget for, but we did. And we've got you know the GMC, which is approaching how many years old? It's approaching.
It's to be replaced 2020 on the CIP right now.
Right now. So it's aging and it's, you know, we're incurring more maintenance issues associated with that. So
So we went from budgeting 13 to almost 29,000. Is the bulk of that accidents or repairs?
I would say the bulk of it is actually repairs. We also had the backhoe, which is, now that it's off warranty, and it, you know, it has been a bit of a lemon.
Wow.
Which is really discouraging.
I caught that backhoe.
It's discouraging. Well, we needed something. So, you know, but it's discouraging. I'll just leave it at that. So we had about 5,000 in that home.
So most of it was accidents?
No, the accidents were about 4,000, 4,000 or 5,000, I think. Backhoe is about 5,000 or 6,000, and then other repairs. You know, the newest vehicle is the Ford, right? So the rest are getting there, are getting on.
Did the last school director have any knowledge of all these repairs that we're going to need and not plan for them?
No, I would not say that. You fix things as it comes up. I mean, you do your normal maintenance, you know, but, you know, when you're doing an inspection or this or that, you have to fix what they tell you you need to fix.
How many vehicles?
We have three trucks, the Bobcat, the backhoe.
All of those needed repairs and maintenance?
Yeah, the Bobcat actually did need something. I don't remember exactly what, but.
No, talking about vehicles, I need a breakdown for the police, the fire, and the highway vehicles. I asked last meeting, just for my general knowledge, so I can see what we have for vehicles.
You mean just an
inventory?
I'm sorry.
No problem.
Yeah, I'm sorry. We'll work on that.
There's only one person that ever made a mistake. The person's never done nothing. No, I have no problem.
Yeah,
I didn't need a
just practice. If you don't see it, somebody send me email because.
What?
Email. I'll have someone send you email. Send me email.
No problem.
Thank you. You just want the age?
What type vehicle and the age, yeah.
Yeah, just regular inventory.
Yeah, regular inventory.
Corey, he'll know that, right?
Yes.
You'll see that.
Pardon?
I said he'll note it so you see it in the minutes.
And that's paper trail.
I'll let you think that through.
It might be something that we might want to consider putting into another report that it continually updates as it is.
Absolutely. It is a find. Absolutely. We this is one of the administrative infrastructure pieces that we don't have, we want to have, we should have. Our auditor tells us every year. So absolutely agree, concur, all of those things. It's a good idea.
Can you give us an update on revenue? I know we had a significant increase in anticipated building permits for this year. Where are we at with that?
There was a slight drop off in let me get to the revenue tab here. In that, but not enough to it's being made up more than made up with the vehicles. So let me bring up. So. So we're about 64% building permits of what the revenue that we anticipated.
What was that again, the anticipated revenue?
64%. So the amount we were anticipating was 45,000. And I mean, and we're still getting them. So, you know, I don't know what it's going to look like at the end, but motor vehicles are currently up 103%, and that's through quarter three. That's not a projection. And that's not counting the surcharge, which goes to a special place.
So currently at 103%?
Yeah, so we budgeted 550,000. We've received 568,000 and some change so far.
Pardon? I have a question about residence tax. They're all due in April. It's off by, almost $4,000. Are there 400 people who are just not bothering to pay their residence tax? Or?
Well, people usually pay them when they come and register their cars, actually, even though they're due.
December 1st is the last.
Yeah,
December. But the thing is, I just got my residence tax and my registration for November. I never got it in April.
Ah.
Oh, wow.
We actually came in to do, I think it was doing the dog or something, we're gonna go, they weren't available.
What?
Yeah.
It's supposed to be all printed.
Well, I didn't get mine until it came in with my, you know how they send your registration and stuff that you're gonna have for that month? It was in there.
Well, maybe I get.
No, it's supposed to be December first.
Suzanne, on the line 21 on revenue, the other licenses, permits and fees, is everything below that?
Yes, yeah, so the 12,000 is a summary of everything below, yeah.
What type, sorry, on the follow-up on the building permits, what types of permits have you seen? Like in terms of new housing versus just housing.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question, and it, you know, being such a data person, I'd love to have captured that more directly so that I could look at that. I mean, clearly the new permits, and we're gonna have to, you know, I doubt, we may not even decide to keep that level of revenue for the coming year, because a lot of the Chinburg houses have now come through. I don't know how many lots there are, but they're more, we've issued more permits than we have empty lots now. So, and other development in the town is just, you know, here and there, like maybe the place on Spruce, is that?
Oh, yeah, the lots up on.
You know.
There could be two lots there.
Yeah, I mean, and so there are things like that. So, but people are, in the Chinburg development, they're adding decks, or they're adding, you know, fireplaces, or they're doing this, that, and the other thing, there's stuff going on in Woods Run. So it's a mess of stuff, but clearly we get the most from new homes. And so if that number, if we anticipate that number's gonna go down, we'll have to rethink the anticipated revenue for FY18.
Can you just talk a little bit about the Parks and Rec? So it looks like there's a shortfall in revenue for them, is that correct?
Yeah, so if you look at my summary, we're actually, we think they've done an amazing job. I mean, we asked them to be revenue neutral, and they came in with a budget. They came in with a, I don't remember what the actual budget was, but their revenues are about $3,500 less than their expenses for this year. So that is really an amazing first go-around, and I think it was a successful year. There's some issues, you know, some process, some kinds of things that the rec committee's ironing out. And just to compare, in FY16, the year before, we had expenses of approximately $24,000, and they were offset by only about $2,000 worth of revenue.
Mm-hmm.
So the town was subsidizing the rec committee, rec program for like $22,000, mm-hmm. and this year it was $3,400.
What was their own expenses this year? Do you know?
Can we ask Jody to?
Sure.
I'm the next
issue
for the rec committee. We had unexpected expenses. The school was doing the paving of that back parking lot, and so we had to keep the kids on field trips for a whole week, which was unexpected. So a bus trip is about $250 a day. 8 hours of bus is about $250. So that was a whole week of unexpected field trips that we took to keep them safe. That was not expected. And then just supplies. They now have walkie-talkies to be able to talk, and just things came up that they saved on, you know, days off, and, you know, I need a couple hours off here, you can go home early, here, there, and there. It was really that week, that extra week. We couldn't keep them at school at all that week. And then the last week they had planned an extra trip because they were gonna need the gym, and because they were gonna redo the floors, but they never got to it. So since we already told the parents, hey, we're still going on, we're going on a field trip, and we're gonna not take them.
I was just wondering, we knew the total expense.
Yeah, can I answer that?
Yep.
If you look at quarter
expenses are, I believe, were already registered at this point. So if you look at the bottom line for rec, just take out the $500 for family day fireworks, and that would be the total expenditure. And I will add that, we, the town, were also responsible for an extra field trip or two, because the day that the contractor broke the water main, it affected us. We couldn't keep the kids at the school because there was no water. So they also, a day or 2 days, I don't know exactly what it was.
Denise?
In the event that, and I have to say that they also did an amazing job this year. I was really proud of everything that everyone had done. It was a great program. In the event, though, that say that they made more money than expenses, where would that money go? Would it be able to
town revenue?
So it can't stay in like a liabilities account or something, some account
to work off
of next year.
Yeah.
I mean,
we're
not
talking,
always be as positive as
we're talking about it. We're talking to, we've had some really, really very preliminary conversations with DRA or our auditor. I think if they were maybe a commission, it's awfully hard to. We're thinking about it. So right now, any overage, just general fund revenue.
Yeah, thank you. Do we have a revenue line item for rec?
It's a couple.
Yes.
So, let's see.
Recreation registration.
55.
There are two or three.
Yeah,
so there's line 55. Maybe I rolled it all up into one. But it actually was accounted for in a couple of different places.
Well, then there's 68 recreation donations.
Okay, so
two
there's
recreation
the other one. Yeah,
sales.
Okay, yeah.
They,
what lines are they?
68 and 69.
That's it. Okay, yeah. They sold T-shirts. They got donations. And they're we're excited. And, it's a really good group. There's a lot of energy, which is nice.
Yeah.
Awesome. Anybody else? Ken, you have anything else?
No.
Okay. You leave that for you and let me see.
Okay, I brought 5 hard copies as requested. So
oh, they're the correct year?
I'm
sparking it myself. I'm allowed to start all myself.
So if anyone needs them,
so snarking and anyone needs them.
Let's first make sure it's the right one.
It should be the right one.
It's like the bottom number 2.
Alright, let me
yep, that's it.
I'll give you all a quick overview of where we are. So first of all, the current school year has essentially just started, even though it officially started July 1st, but for July and August, so for the first quarter ended the end of September, and but the first couple months, it's not a whole lot being expended. So the current year is essentially just underway, so everything looks really good at this point, because we're just starting out. Some lines are not properly encumbered, which you may see on some of it. And that's because we still need accurate Marshwood enrollment residency figures. We're still going back and forth on some of the residency and some of those figures, just getting them accurately in. So that's one of the reasons it's not there all properly. And I just want to let everyone know here, we can't take for granted, even though I said it, that the current year always starts out in good shape. If any of you have been reading the paper, you've seen that there's been some problems in Summersworth. So our board is very grateful for the help that the SAU gives us in getting our budget together and the careful oversight that our board has been doing for the last few years. So that things do start out well each year. It's important that we've worked together well over the last few years and done a very good job with that. So
just a quick question. I know it's been in the news and everything else, because the SAU is holding money. Do you by any perchance know how much of that share of the money is actually Rollinsford's money?
Actually, I do know, because I keep a very close look at that.
I know you do,
as time goes on. So school districts, as I know I've explained to everyone, are not allowed to hold fund balances.
Mm-hmm.
Towns are, but SAU districts, because they're their own entities, they're actually considered a corporation, are allowed to have a fund balance. And so a fund balance has been in place, I think Denise knows when it went into place.
Quite a while ago.
So it's been around for a lot of years.
Yeah.
And it has been used judiciously over the last 5 years that I've been involved to help offset any increases in the SAU budget so that the taxes don't go up because of the SAU for either community. And because it's been in the paper so much, I did some math for it. So because we will be having an SAU meeting on November 1st, I believe it will be at a conference room in Somersworth. It should be publicly posted tomorrow, I hope, no later than I asked today when it will be done. And this question will come up. So Rollinsford's share of that entire budget is about 16%. That's about what we've contributed to it. That's the five-year average, so.
Okay. I was just curious because they were asking.
Absolutely. So, yes, I wanted to make sure we all had, that I had the math on that so I could represent us all well when that happened. So, thank you, Chris. All right, so FY17, which is the last school year, so the school year that finished in June, has been closed out and reported to the various state agencies. I know that I believe the board, that the budget committee received an electronic copy of that, the book that's sent to the DRA, the Department of Revenue, Department of Revenue Administration. And it's those financials that the DRA uses to set the local education portion of our December tax rate. So what's been reported to them is what's going to be used to help set that, to set that tax rate. We started working on, so I'm now working backward and forward, and I'll get right back to the first quarter here in a minute. But, and we started work on next year's budget, so for FY19, so the next school year. With preliminary discussions a couple weeks ago, our next budget workshop for all of those of you who are interested will be November 9th at 5:30, just before the board meeting. And other current news, we're currently in negotiations with the Rollinsford Grade School Union, that's the Rollinsford Education Association, and they represent the teachers and the paraprofessionals. I can't discuss ongoing negotiations, so we will all be spared my impassioned explanations and pleas about, you know, steps and all that. We'll get all to that once we have a signed, agreed to a collective bargaining agreement. I won't get into any of that this evening. And the other piece of updated news, just to keep current, is that the RBS administration and facilities manager have been using the IEB study that we did 4 years ago now to lay out a comprehensive RGS CIP. The identified items will hopefully be incorporated into the town CIP. I have not been able to make it to the town CIP meeting, but I will be able to go to the next one. So they've really laid out one for the school. And it'd be nice when we get them combined with the town so that everyone in town can see everything all in one place. And one of the positive outcomes of creating that RGS CIP is that we are now able to note that many of the things identified, the issues that IEP study identified, is they've actually addressed over the past 2 or 3 years. By using the savings that we have found at RGS, as we said a number of years ago, when we said that we were trying to look for savings at RGS, we've saved it, but we reinvested it back into the school, and we've been able to knock off a lot of the items that are on there. Last 2 or 3 years, so the reinvestment, and also it's not just the reinvestment, it's also the fact that the budget committee and the town have supported some warrants that have helped us to do it as well. So things like three-phase power, which is complete, asbestos removal, replacement of lifts, paving, annex windows, plumbing upgrades, storage, and much more has already been addressed. So it's nice that they're keeping a list of those things too that have happened. And the other thing we expect to do this year at the school is to make two requests for information/proposals. One is to get an understanding of what it would take to put in a secure entrance, get a plan for a secure entrance. We do not have anything that meets any security measures at all for our entrance. And a retrofit of the main building, a 1936 original ventilation system. We
that needs to be looked at, and also the annex ventilation, which is also probably original to the 1960s when it was built. So we're just looking for a request for information so we would know what those would cost.
I see the CIP, what the school's got here, like in 2018 and 19, 185,000, the following year 300, then 400, 400, 445. Where's this money going to come from?
Well,
CIP, I thought, was something that you planned for and did later. These things seem like they're coming right up.
They do seem to be coming up, and that's why you really have that discussion. When you're looking at a very preliminary one, when I get together with the CIP, whenever it is in a couple of weeks, some of those things will be laid out. But some of them are coming up quickly, that is true.
I'm just wondering how you're going to save the money for it.
Who knows? We'll see.
Okay.
One of the things we do know, we learned it last year, and it was always good to be able to report it to this committee and to the town, that our building fund, our building, whatever it's called,
reserve
fund, can be used as a CIP. So we do have that, we do have some money in there. We have, as a matter of fact, we have about just over $100,000 in there right now. So we have some money there. But the whole, yes, we need a CIP to start planning our money, but we also needed to know what needs to be done. And again, all of those timelines are based on the IEP study at this time. So.
Now that building fund, you got to have a special meeting to pull the money out?
Yes, just like you pulled any money out of, yes, we have to say we're going to take, $50,000 out, and we're also, just like every year we have to put money into it,
yep.
The town has to vote to put money into it, if we're going to do it, we have to have the same vote to pull the money out.
Okay.
Correct. Just the way the town does and the way we do that with the school. So anyway, so I'm happy to take any questions or comments now on the first quarter budget. I think we've all had a chance to look at it.
I'd like to back up. On the fourth quarter, I had some questions.
Okay.
On the surplus that was left over for last year,
mm-hmm.
Where'd that money come from, the repairs? You went and spent $150,000. I just want to know where the breakdown, where the money came from, what accounts.
I'm sorry, what?
I asked last meeting at the 2630 maintenance ground. You spent $150,000,
yes,
on repairs. I just want to know where that money came from.
Yes, that was the warrants from the year before get rolled into it.
No,
plus some, right.
The shed wasn't on that.
The shed is in this year. Is actually in this year's budget because the shed was the,
yeah, but it was last year's
surplus,
money.
Was the surplus?
It was last year's money though.
Right. That's true. Right?
Yeah. That's why I want to know what account that came from.
It's bottom line money that was left over.
Okay,
so
you don't have any special lines?
Nothing.
What was over?
Well, there were a number of lines that were over.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean,
I'll look through it. I just thought you'd have a breakdown of where the money came from.
Well, we had special ed savings of almost $100,000.
Okay.
So that's part of it. We had regular education savings of about $12,000. We had speech, speech ideology. I have to look at my lines here.
Yeah.
We had benefit savings there of over $10,000. So that's the money. That's it right
there.
Okay. So we look at the bottom line when we, late in the year, when we know we're going to have money left over, we look at the bottom line. We don't go back and say what line are we taking it from. We just look at the bottom line.
And the
113, okay.
Follow up on that again. The 113,000, has that been turned over to the town from last year's surplus?
No, that's part of what is being reported to the DRA.
Okay.
Right now.
I just didn't know how that, I know it comes back,
yeah,
and you know how.
Actually learning more about it as it goes along. It's a relatively new thing that the school's allowed to sort of hang on to that money for a while.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the year, they actually take it and add it to the surplus from this year and do other things. They have their own formulas that they do. Our goal this year is that the town will see $100,000. That's our goal. We're working on that right now. And that $100,000 will be used directly to reduce overall taxes in the town.
Oh, so
think you kind of answered part of my question. I wanted to know what percentage of spent costs for the Mars board were spent versus appropriated. So if you appropriated so much, what was the percentage spent?
Well, you should, it should be there in the details of the fourth quarter of the last year. The,
I don't,
we didn't get, and actually we don't get it, we did not get it broken out as Marshwood and so I actually don't know. I mean, what we did have, if we had special ed money left over, $97,000. So I'm going to assume that most of that was on
Was it sent to
Yeah, I don't see that.
If we went electronically, Michelle sent it out to the whole community.
I have to do it. And the year was up.
Well, that was the DRA one. I don't know about the closing.
No.
Was it
possible?
It was at our
last meeting when that was the budget we were looking at.
That was the final budget. Yeah.
Just as a matter of information, I have here the Rumsford budget update. It goes through June 30th.
Yep.
And it's the detail page.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, so anyway, everybody else wants it, I can send it. Yeah, but you have to fill out the subscription. Yes, there was some speech, but it was savings at RGS, but that had to do with benefits change, not with services. It marshaled it with all these services.
Suzanne, Vern, Ed, and
Ed. Mine is just a quick sign from one of the public grants to the school district for the donation of the projector system that we have. It's a smart board, but we're really using it for projection and not together. So we are going to put the white board up here so that people can continue to use it. We don't want to use that as a white board for the school district. So I realize we should probably put a note on there so no one does that. So thank you very much.
The school is very happy.
And Dick from the facilities manager and Richard for you, our commitments got spent the time to
Well, the school was happy to find a home for it because it was no longer working for the as a smart board.
Works great as a projector.
We don't need it as a smart board here. Right?
Well, I was going to say if you want the numbers, you want special ed costs to Marshwood, Summersworth, private school, as the end of last fiscal year?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, and just, we have a report that we have to send it.
Yeah.
It's
on, just make a note, it's on page 4 of the detailed report.
Thank you. And
Dennis,
thank you very much.
Yeah, I have a question. Do we have full dedicated to the
We do.
Are we expecting any revenue?
Next year, and it will not be the full percentage. I think they're funding it at whatever it is, 60 or 70. Well, who knows, right? If we're going to get it, the state keeps changing its mind, but they have voted to give to reimburse us 100% for full day kindergarten. All school districts that do it. They're starting out next year at a reduced, not at the 100%, but at the, I'm trying to read the paper, 60 or 70%. So we would expect some, not next year, but actually it's not next year. It's not going to be in our next year's budget as revenue, but fiscal year 20. No, we don't. We are not. No, it is only the cities that are voting, I think, on it now. Right? From what I've been reading, it's only the cities that are voting.
I just got back to a question which I don't expect to answer. One question. When I look at the long range buying out, if you are putting some substantial expenditures in the school now, which implies that we decided we're going to keep this building for X more years, which I don't know what it is. And so my question is, are we putting enough money aside? Right now, we have a certain amount of depreciation per year on this. So, I don't know. I don't think I can figure that out. I know that somebody should say that this building is worth X millions of dollars just as it is. And then it's depreciating how much per year. So thought. I'm really asking, we bring enough money ahead and these funds and so forth to fix what we need to fix in the next 10 years or whatever time period. So I don't know, compare, or are we getting further behind all the time? Or are we really keeping right up with what we should be?
That's an excellent question, Ed. And I think that about 3 years ago, the board very seriously knew that we'd fallen very far behind. And so we made a concerted effort to save money in RGS operating costs and put it back into the building. Some of you may remember that there was some talk about doing the whole thing all at once and bonding a few million dollars. Some of you may remember that. And that the town was not interested in doing that at that time. So the board decided at that time that we would look at putting $200,000-$300,000 in a year to cover the $2 to $5 million that we needed to get it up to where it needed to go. And so we're working our way toward that, and we've made great strides toward that. It would be a great idea to get the building valued. We have had at least three separate sets of engineers in looking at that main building. And they have said it is sound, it is beautifully built, it is a great building. So I feel that anything we're doing to it is a good value for the town. So,
but there are other people from the state or so forth that say, well, you're out of line with the warrants, or whatever they call it, what we should be doing. And so we're going to condemn that one of these times. And so are they going to condemn it 6 years from now? Or are they going to condemn it 20 years from now? As long as you keep putting how much maintenance in this year?
We have a number of waivers from the state because it's an old building. So we have waivers that allow us to have smaller than legally permitted classroom sizes. We have waivers, that's the one that comes mostly to mind, but there are even some ADA safety waivers that we have because we can't put in an elevator very easily. So we have to have the lift. That's why we've replaced all the lifts in the last 2 years so that we're ADA compliant. So we're working on it, but these are good things, and we'll look into getting the building valued, I think, see what, how that works.
Yeah, I'm an advocate of getting much life out of this building and expanding its life if it's very feasible, but if it's only got about 10 years more expansion and then the whole thing will blow up on it, then I'll look at it a different way than I look at it if it's got 20 or 30 years life. I won't be here either way at that time, but
my grandchildren may be around. At that point, so.
One of the things that on previous year's budget, your special education firm, Marshwood, was extremely time-based because we didn't know what it was going to cost because
we did know what it was going to cost based on they said a unit of speech. We thought a unit was an hour.
Right.
They said their unit was not an hour. So we were charging an hour. They were charging us for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
It was that kind of thing.
Right.
Now, that is still being worked out. They are still working that out.
Okay. That was my follow-up question, because we can't continue to have our budget be exceedingly higher because Marshall can't get their act together to cut it and tell us what it's going to be. It had a year.
Correct.
They should be able to do it.
This
coming budget.
In the budget for 2019, it is supposed to be much, much higher in terms of the actual cost.
They have to know what their time allotment is and what their hourly rate is.
And part of this is that we pay special ed, I think, twice a year,
mm-hmm.
and we didn't even get the first special ed bill until after the. I mean, we didn't get the final special ed bill, so we knew what our final costs were until after a year and a half of transition was done. And now, so it's like we are playing so much catch up that I actually applaud our special ed director, our business analyst, and spent so much time with Marshall as the special ed director and business analyst. I mean, they are really getting down into the weeds on this and getting it.
we've been promised that it's going to be much tighter.
I hope so, because I mean, we can't continue to have our budget so high that then we find no. The special ed is an unknown anyway. We have one move in and it can destroy a budget.
Well, I will share, because it is public knowledge, one of Summer's work problems is that they had a $300,000 swing on one special ed student.
And when I tell you all this
or say this at town meeting, everyone goes, oh, that'll never happen. Well, they just saw it happen in Summer's work.
Absolutely.
So it can happen.
But we really have to be making sure that Marcia draws in those numbers tighter than they have.
Totally agree, and I'll
get it. Yeah. Thank you.
Well,
just real quick, I think Ed's point earlier, many of those issues we're trying to address through capital improvement and working with the school board and getting together so that we can identify the maintenance needs and what we need to do long-term expenses and so forth, and putting them in the capital improvement budget so we can say, okay, let everybody in town know needs of the anticipated expenses so it doesn't come as a surprise. So, mm-hmm. Okay.
What is the base tuition cost for our master's student?
I think it's about 11,000. A little under that. I think it's either 10.5 or 11. And we do not have the tuition rate yet for next year. We're still waiting on that for the budget, so our next year's budget. We should have it by now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is it the same for middle and high?
Yes, it's the same for middle and high, and it would be the same for elementary. Okay. It would be the same no matter what, even though we know that middle school is a little less. Mm-hmm. And that elementary is us, they charge the same tuition to us.
If I just clarify,
that does not include special ed, because that's all kinds.
That's correct.
Compare that to what Summer's Worth tuition was, because theirs had a bunch.
Not what it was, correct. Not what it was. What it is now, yes, because we pay a straight tuition, right? We have our last group of students at Summer's Worth this year. We pay a straight tuition for them, which is higher. It's about 12,000 or 12.5, I think, this year. 12.5 this year, and special ed for them. And we do have special ed students there. Is a tiered approach, though, not an a la carte tiered approach.
But special ed students get charged the regular tuition rate, and on top of that,
correct.
The special ed
correct.
Services. So
that
it's
correct.
It's together at the end of the day.
Yes. Okay. And our new superintendent has had a talk with the Marshwood superintendent because she discussed with the board before she had this talk, obviously, saying, you know, a tiered approach at Marshwood might work a lot easier as well. First of all, it would save countless hours of work, and it would work out about the same money-wise. And so we may be looking at a change of how our special
What can you describe what you mean by tiered?
Yeah, so right now we pay a la carte back to Marshwood. We pay tiered to Summer's Worth. So basically you take a student who might have speech needs, and so they might become tier one. And so you would add $1,000 to that student. And then they might need more than that. They might need speech, and they might need an aid in a couple of classes. So that would be tier two. And then there might be, and usually it's three tiers. So they it's a different tier rather than trying to figure out every nickel and dime, you place students generally where they belong.
And every IEP would specify what that tier
very
is.
Very clearly laid out.
Based on their circumstances.
Yes.
Does Marshwood, if Marshwood in their budget, do they do it? The way that they're charging rounds for the special ed, is it the cost of the student, and then on top of that, the special ed, and that's why, is that how they do it? For their own students?
For their own students?
Yeah, in their budget, in their students.
You know, I have looked at their budget many times, but I have not looked at that level of detail. And I'm not even that would be interesting to look more closely at, because I do look to see what. The only thing they count on for revenue in their budget, I believe, is our base tuition. And then of course, the special ed is another one.
Yeah. So we have budgeted for three emergency centers?
Yeah.
Did we fill those up?
That's this year, right?
We don't know yet. I mean, this year has just started.
So you haven't, so that, so far, they have, you haven't had any.
We don't have a final count for a month. That's why we haven't encumbered a certain amount of, we haven't encumbered the money yet for regular education because we don't have a final count for March and or agreement on residency.
So you don't really know how many of our students are in there?
No, we know how many we're planning on at the moment, but there are some still, they're still being finalized. So right now, in total, we have 150 middle school and high school.
Do you know how much enrollment is in Rawlinsburg?
In Rawlinsburg, yes. It's 154. We had a, yeah, I know. But it's actually, we had a couple of students leave Rawlinsburg grade school, and four kindergartners move in. Just like 3 weeks ago. So we have a kindergarten bubble. Yeah. About to come up through the school. It's marvelous. Because again, it fluctuates a great deal in grade school, right up through January and February. It fluctuates a tremendous amount. And you're right, in June it was 156, and right now we're just at 154, so yeah. It fluctuates a lot.
On Summersworth, how many students do we have going to Summersworth?
We have 12 at the moment.
Yes. How do we get an increase?
Yeah, I asked that same question, and the very simple answer, and I can say no more about it, is that it's special ed related.
Okay. And that's for only half a year?
That's what we said at the school board.
But that never can. That's it. They stopped when they were out of it, right?
That is correct. That is correct.
For
last
seniors.
Year, having students, they're all seniors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this last spring, we talked a little bit about potentially moving sixth graders.
Yes. Yeah. We chose not to do that right away last year, but yeah, it's always on the back of our minds.
So it won't be part of the discussion for this year's budget.
Not for this year's budget. No, I mean, we know what it will cost, in essence, so we have to, yeah.
I mean, you're not thinking about making that move in as you're planning a budget.
That is correct.
How about coaching teachers? What are you thinking about cost-saving moves this year?
Well, we've made about as many cost-saving moves as we can make staff-wise. As a matter of fact, we had to hire two more special ed paraprofessionals because of people who moved in. To town. So, and that's something that's always going to be an unknown. We just never know. But our staff is pretty much down to what it can be down to. It's flexible enough now to move through the bubbles and do things. But I'm not sure there's going to be much actually within staff change.
So the coaching model isn't really evolving.
Well, the teaching model has saved us some money. And the savings, of course, will continue each year, but we don't expect to hire any more teachers.
And not in
school. No, we're pretty much down to bare bones.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Did we have any other questions for Judy?
Thank you all.
Right. Is there any other matters?
Well, of course. I mean, I've been greatly appreciative of you as vice chair of not taking over the chair position, but if you don't, of course, you can have a vice chair.
Oh, she has a chair.
Well, it
depends on whether she wants go as chair or
That's a little taste of power.
if I were to chair, I would need a vice chair. That's my family. I don't mind doing it, but I would need
support in the personal vice chair. I just want to make sure.
You know the vice chair has to be other than the public.
That's my hope.
And please know that the town is happy to assist in any way we can if there's something that we can do.
So I don't know what the proper procedure is at this point. Do we?
We can simplify by asking if you would decline. If you don't decline, that makes it easier.
Well, do you want to be chair?
As long as there's a vice chair.
I would do it as long as there's a vice chair.
Then I'll make a motion that she be elevated from vice chair to chair.
Second.
That's all it takes. Okay?
Okay, well, we need to vote on that.
Yes, we do.
Vice chair.
So all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Are you going to say no?
Now you have nominations for vice chair.
So then we need nominations for vice chair.
Right.
And I'd like to nominate Denise Knowles.
A second.
And you will.
Now, did it?
Yes, it did.
So all in favor of Denise being vice chair?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay.
Mazel tov to you both.
Thank you both.
Yeah, thank you both.
Yes, thank you.
Just one follow-up.
Yeah.
Do we have a finalized schedule now?
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Well.
Yes, so just a little, because that was a fiasco. So what had happened is we had the schedule changes that we made in December, which Corey had a great notes on. I didn't have it electronically. Vern sent it to me electronically, made the changes. I posted it. However, for some reason, November changed. I don't know why. And I didn't pick up on it until the police and the librarian said, it's Thanksgiving Eve. And I'm like, oh, we would never have done that. So I went back and I looked and saw the old schedule. And so obviously I sent emails and told everybody what was going on. So we just fixed it back to the 29th in November, notified those departments, and everybody was good. So the schedule that's posted on the website, out here in the library field and all of that is the correct schedule.
Can you send it to the budget committee?
Sure.
It's going to change somebody.
Or maybe we should put it on, like, through Tia. And put it on the
It is on the website.
No, I meant like an announcement that this is the schedule for the upcoming, like she sends her announcements
out. Yep. Okay.
And then you can say it's also on the website or whatever.
Yep, I can
read
that.
Or
now Denise again.
No, I can't.
I can handle that one. I can do that.
No.
And I are best friends
Rick,
now.
It's pretty good. Throw it down the line.
So you just want her to send out an email about the new budget schedule.
Well, it's on the website.
The schedule for the school, do you know if that's...
Schedule for the school is fine.
It's fine.
Because we changed it to December 14th.
Okay.
And I believe it's going to be held at the school. I thought I saw that it's going to be held at the school.
Yeah,
right.
It usually is. But your deliberative sessions and all of those dates are all set?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's one of the reasons we changed our meeting date as well.
Okay.
So from what...
I'm sorry,
13th,
whatever it is.
Okay. Yeah. So what we have here, Judy, is correct.
As far as I know.
I just want to make sure I know all of their requirements.
As far as I know, I haven't looked it over again. I didn't look at anything else again, so
yeah.
I changed it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you.
Just want to make sure, because that was...
So we have enough then next Wednesday.
But yeah, thank you, Denise.
No. It's 11:29.
It's 11:29.
And I do have one question. There was talk about
Their chairs are softer.
Yes.
Because they have no projection capability.
For what it's worth, I think it's good for the school for people to be able to see it, since you're paying for it. And I think sometimes, unless it's going to be a huge, crazy meeting, I think it's, it gets people in there.
It's the parking, and I understand that. But it's more convenient for the town because of the projection capabilities.
And for the school as well, for the projecting.
Yeah, I think that the concern was is because of the amount of parking.
And access. And the bar next door.
Unless you have something really huge on your budget, we probably can do it at the grade school.
Right, I mean, I could expect sometimes where we've had
attendance.
The kindergarten and things, where, yeah, there was no way, you know. Does anybody have anything else that we need to talk about? So a motion to adjourn?
I would make such a motion.
Yay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Corey, you were all set, right, with sending the time and the updates and all that?
Yeah, no.
This paper looks like it's 2 years old.
I think it's white.
Yellow, it looks yellow.
Is that from the, is that from your print?
No, I think that's from the water.
Well, our meeting,
they're going to want to see where the election is.